Jeremy,
hey.
Back at IBC, and now you have brought us the Shogun Inferno in the final version.
Yes, we have. Finally, we're getting it out there. Yeah, the 4K 60 capability was a little bit harder than we thought, so it's taking a little bit longer, so we apologize for the delay, but we're there now. So
it's shipping now?
Yes, shipping now.
Cool. So can you round up a little bit for all of those who don't know Atomos, who is probably just like two or three people,
yes.
But what is the Shogun Inferno doing?
Okay, so it's a 4K P60, up to 4K P60, so it does 4K 50 as well, like for the PAL countries.
Yeah.
We can do Cinema DNG recording, we can do Apple ProRes, we can do DNX at those frame rates, and we can also do HD 240 to ProRes or DNX from a RAW solution, like we're showing here on the FS5, yeah. Where we're coming out 4K P50 in RAW, and we're recording directly to ProRes. So you can do continuous high frame rate, or you could put it into HD mode and do 240 frames a second continuous recording, which is great for the sports guys as well. And we've announced some new features. So we support all the same RAW that we did in Shogun,
yeah.
And in Flame.
Yeah.
And we've also added, because we've got extra grunt inside the Inferno, we've added ARRI RAW direct recording, mm-hmm. And then Cinema DNG from ARRI RAW.
Yeah.
Right, and then you can also go to ProRes if you'd like, and we do Vericam LT RAW recording to Cinema DNG. So that's a nice solution because that's like an 18,000 euro camera. So it's kind of, it's not up in the 50 to 100 like an ARRI or a RED. It's sitting in that kind of middle space, and I think but the sensor is phenomenal, and I think the Sony are doing an awesome job at sub 10,000.
Yeah.
I really like the Vericam in that middle range,
yeah.
And whichever one you've got.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter because we'll give you the recording that you require, plus the HDR, 1500 nits, 7-inch high bright monitor, which then can, in Atom HDR mode, can turn into your HDR monitoring. And we've also announced hybrid log gamma and PQ input and output support. So the output is so you can play back to a TV, and the input is so that you can edit and you can monitor using this monitor as your grading monitor when you're on the laptop.
You have been a little bit too fast because now you jumped over all the stuff with SDI connection,
yes.
HDMI connection, and RAW. Maybe it's important to explain that. This is a FS5 with a RAW option. So it has a SDI out.
Correct.
And with this option, it get RAW out. And then this device allows to record this RAW. And the funny thing is that the FS5 has no 4K 50 60p support
internally,
but if you record externally, so that's an extra bonus,
yes.
Yeah, having RAW, you can record this much higher quality in RAW in
Cinema 10
bit
in 10 bit 10 bit RAW,
yeah.
And in Cinema DNG,
yeah.
Right, or in ProRes or DNX. So you can turn it into a 60p ProRes camera through the RAW option.
Yeah.
So what does that cost you? You said about 800 euro or something like that.
Yeah.
So you buy that option for your FS5, you get into the camera for about 7 grand, another grand for the RAW option, 2,000 for the Inferno. Under $10,000, you have a 4K P60, amazing broadcast or cinema solution.
Yeah.
I think that's a very compelling bundle.
And even if you're not going to use the RAW function in the beginning, maybe you know that if you have the Inferno, you have the possibility with the RAW upgrade to get more functionality.
Yeah, and maybe one of your customers one day says, you know, I would like a RAW recording, please. And then you can just buy the option and use your Inferno and away you go. So what we're trying to do is add that flexibility, because production companies today are struggling with, I've got X camera,
yeah.
But then I get Y job, and they want a different camera or they want something else. So our job, we believe, is to glue things together nicely so that you can just go rent the camera you need and be flexible, but invest in the ones that your main workhorse. So this type of solution would be your main workhorse. And then when you need to go up a level, add the RAW option and the Inferno.
Yeah.
If you just need to deliver 4K HDR, then you can do that. Or if it's just Rec 709 normal video recording, which seems funny to talk about now because HDR looks so good that I don't know why you wouldn't record it.
Yeah.
But now you can obviously use that as the right exposure tool and never get that wrong for whatever recording you're doing. So we want to be flexible with our solution and give customers options so that they're not hamstrung by the equipment they bought.
Maybe it's important also to name the benefit you get by recording to SSD and not an expensive card.
Yeah, so I think, first of all, the computer industry commodity storage is much more affordable.
Yeah.
number one. It's more accessible. You don't have to go to a pro guy to get a P2 card or an S-by-S card that's fast enough, and then you're paying too much. You know that as a customer. You know, you're not feeling good about the... You know that the you can buy a 1 terabyte drive for $400, but they're trying to make you buy a 512 card for $3,000. You know, that it doesn't make sense to customers. So I think the accessibility of going to any store, any SanDisk, any Intel drive, any that we've tested, you can go buy. So it doesn't matter where you are in the world, you could be on an African safari, there is a computer store in Africa, I promise you, that you're going to be able to buy a disc from. Yeah. And that's important. That's why SSD, non-proprietary, is really important. And we've announced, as you guys know, and I know you sell G-Tech as well, and cover that, that combination of the G-Tech Atomos Caddy, where they're selling SanDisk and Hitachi drives. Hitachi is the HD version. Mm-hmm. SanDisk is the 4K30 and then 4K60 drives. You just got to be careful which one you buy for whichever solution, Inferno, Flame, or the older products. And that combination just gives you that peace of mind that this is the number one solution that we are recommending with a company like G-Tech. But it doesn't mean that we're limiting you to that. Yeah. You can still go and buy a SanDisk drive separately and put it in a caddy that you've got and use it. So flexibility is my message. Offering tomorrow's solutions today to future-proof production companies is what we're about. So if you buy an Inferno, I guarantee you for the next 3 years minimum, you're going to have the latest and greatest. And we're going to keep updating that software to give you better and better features. Things like hopefully controlling the camera are on our radar, and connecting devices together for gen lock and things. We've already got that covered, so you can start to do multicam shoots in really high quality.
Okay. Well, you talked about HDR and the possibilities with the monitor and upcoming features, but can you just name, why is it not only a recording tool, but also a very great monitor?
Yeah, because I think the thing from my perspective is we have all the algorithms perfect from Sony, from Panasonic, oh, this is RAW, so it's only Sony, Canon, Arri, etc. So we can, because we make all of our own panels, well, we buy the panel and we do our own LED backlight, we control the colors of those LEDs, we control the brightness display curves as we put them onto the screen. So we have complete control over the image, which allows us to, in a 1500 nit panel, map perfectly what we can see with our eyes. And when you see this type, I mean, you're looking at this now, that looks like what I'm looking at here. Whereas in Rec 709, I'm always compromising where I'm coming to and from. And that log footage, you know, just doesn't look as good as when I'm in Atom HDR, where it really pops everything, gives you that brightness range that your eye is used to seeing in real life.
So you see the picture in a better quality, or if you look at the monitor of your
Which
camera itself, it's also much smaller.
Yes.
but there are some other helps you can get from the monitor. Can you show them?
Yes, for sure. So you've got things like, in terms of monitoring functions, you've got all your normal things like focus peaking. Let me get out of the. Unfortunately, in the RAW mode, I haven't got these active.
Oh, okay. But we can probably look at.
But we can look at the next one over here, the flame over here. Okay. And what you've got is you've got your waveform monitoring tools, which give you the ability to monitor your high dynamic range signal, and then ensure when I'm in HDR mode that I'm adjusting the brightness range to match my scene. This is really important so that I get the exposure correct. So they're exposure tools, and these are all the test measurement tools. And we've got vector scope, vector zoom. And then you go into monitor tools, which are your focus peaking to make sure you're on the right focus point. You've got frame guides for different types of productions. So we've got all those monitoring tools that allow you to set the thing up. If you've got anamorphic lenses, we can do an anamorphic D squeeze for you. So there's a bunch of features here that, depending on the flexible, whatever your customer wants, we have tried to think of how to make that an easy solution for you. And there's a lot of things like people say, well, I want to punch in, they always say. And so I can punch in and move my things around, and I can adjust my focus here so that I know that I'm perfect, and then I can come back out and make sure that I'm, you know, filming the right things. And then I've got metadata tagging, and then, of course, the HDR mode, log, native, and here's where I can really get that beautiful HDR image. And now with PQ output and HDL output, HLG, so hybrid log gamma. We can go to any of the TVs that are now in the stores. So a lot of the Sonys, Panasonics are PQ, LG and Samsung have gone for hybrid log gamma. It doesn't matter what HDR TV you've got, we can support it, and you can show your clients what it looks like on these on with a really nice high dynamic range image.
Just to give me an understanding about this, so when I'm outputting hybrid log gamma,
yes.
Is it like this? I connect the big screen to the HDMI out, and do they still have the possibility then to interpret my material?
So yes, can you I? Do. You can edit. You can. So, for example, if I hit play here, and all my footage that's coming that I've just been recording at the show, right? Yeah. I can come in and I can do, for example, there's a few features. I can do slow motion. Yeah, I can pause frame by frame. And then I can come in and do a cut edit, in point, out point, right? And I can do lots of different, these rejects, for example. I can go to the next clip. And one more I'll do. And I can do another in point, out point. And now, when I go to my playlist, I can go playlist, yes? And in here, I can say play all my favorites.
Okay.
So this is my rushes for the customer, right? So then I'm like, okay, I'm gonna play these, and then I hit play, and it puts together, you can see one, two clips, my favorites that I just tagged, it puts those together, and I can have my customer watch what I'm doing and say, you know what, I like that, and that can be playing out to the HDR TV in perfect quality.
And when it's playing out to in HDR, can I change this the slider, so the color?
You wouldn't do that, because what we're actually doing is wherever they recorded it, yeah. Right? Yes, you can. You can adjust the slider while you're going, and that will convert from whatever that range is to the right PQ level or the right hybrid log gamma. So the answer is yes, you can adjust it. But it will always look good. That's because in HDR, there's so many things going on, right? There's color, there's brightness, there's log curves in the background, and then there's the standards to go to the TV. If you get one of those wrong in the chain, it really looks ugly. It looks very ugly. So what we've done is we've made sure that no matter what the user does, we will show you an exceptionally nice image on the screen. You might get a little bit better quality by or a brighter range, but you won't screw up the image in front of your customer, and you'll get a 98% accurate representation of what if you did finish the footage completely in a color grading editing package and then transmitted it over a broadcast standard to your HDR TV, that what you saw in pre-production will be 98% of the quality that you get at the end. So it will be a little bit better in the final grade, of course, but you're 98% there, and therefore you're not going to make any mistakes.
Okay, just for my understanding, once again, so the material I would ingest from the editing system, or is it really like this that I can go the way camera, Shogun, and then out to the HDR monitor?
Yes, camera, Shogun, out to the HDR monitor is one workflow.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's, I would recommend that for, I'm just shooting, I'm doing a quick cut edit, and I'm showing the customer or checking it myself to see what it's gonna look like, right? So that's a pre-check. The other way to do it is I've recorded the footage already, and I don't have the camera here. I've gone to the client, and then I can just play out and watch it, right?
Yeah.
And then the third option is I'm connected to Premiere Pro. I'm monitoring it like you saw at Grass Valley from Edius.
Yeah.
I'm monitoring, I'm grading, and then I'm looping that out to a TV so I can see on a grading monitor, the 10-bit, wonderful pro features, great panel from Atomos, etc., with Atom HDR, and you can see it properly. And then I can put that out to a big TV and see what it's going to look like in the final production.
Okay.
So I think you've got all angles covered, and whatever you can think of to in the chain, we will make sure that it looks great on all of those monitors.
Big question, what is missing now? if you look at the Inferno, I mean, people have been discussing a lot, why can I not record 4K 5060p? Yeah, now there's the Inferno, who does?
Yes.
Then all this discussion about raw recording, when will we be able? Now.
Okay,
so what can people say to you?
Well, I think what I'd like to do now is control the camera, because there's a lot of rigging situations where our monitor is the main control surface. Yeah. But they still have to get down into the camera or have a separate remote for the camera controls. So yeah. We're working closely with all the Japanese camera makers as well as the Aries and the Reds, etc. And I'm beelining towards some control surfaces to control the camera. Yeah. And that, I think, just integrates things a bit better, lets you use whichever lens and sensor you love. And from whichever maker, if you're a Sony guy, you're a Canon guy, it doesn't matter to us. Yeah. We just want to record the best quality from those lenses and sensors. And I think controlling the camera is the next thing. But that's about all I can think of right now.
Yeah. Well, that sounds like a nice wish. And if you name it, I guess many would say, yeah, well, sure. Because they know the problem. Typing on their tiny little display, in many cases, won't make the game. So especially if you want to set something in focus,
yes.
And you're not even allowed to point it because it's so small or something, then a bigger display will help you. And of course, if you're working outside with a brightness, you have a perfect device to control.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think those things just make it the Swiss Army knife of the video industry, right? That's what we're trying to do, is give you something you can pull out and you can always use. I mean, what I loved the other day, I was with my friend and he was trying to show his employees how to use their new CRM app that he'd implemented for this company, right? He's not in video or anything, right? And he said, yeah, I'm trying to take screenshots to show them how to use the app on the iPad or on their phone. And I said, well, just grab the HDMI output and record it to a flame. And we did. And then he quickly edited it on our device and then whacked it up to YouTube and showed put it on his internal server and showed his colleagues and his employees.
You know what? We did the same.
Did
and,
you?
And especially with HDMI 2.0, we have even more possibilities and higher quality by doing so.
Yes.
So this is an extra functionality which you might not think of in the beginning, but it is. Yeah. So it's also doing computer signals converting into nice video quality where you after can show how you can really record your desktop
exactly.
In a very high
or app on any phone or device, anything that's got an HDMI out with an adapter we can record from. And I think one other area that's been really big for us in the last year is the gaming community at 120 frames a second on the Shogun and on the Flames. They're loving it, and now PlayStation's going to 240 frames a second. They need the Inferno. So there's lots of, it is that video, flexible video tool for everybody.
Yeah. So I see the only thing is missing is that you can control your PlayStation.
That's right. So we need to put the X buttons and I'll talk to Sony.
Okay. Well, just a last word maybe about the nice thing which is hanging here. What's that?
Okay. So when we were doing 4K60, we realized that the HDMI cables weren't 2.0 compatible. Yeah. Our cables would, some of them were fine at 4K60, others would only do 4K30, and they couldn't quite cut it for 4K60. So we have designed our own 4K60 cable, super high quality, pro video approved. It will do RAW, it will do ProRes, it will do high dynamic range, and they're really affordable, $100 for this cable, which gives you that peace of mind that you're never gonna not have the right signal strength to record your footage from your camera.
And very flexible because it's curled, so you have different distances. You don't get a mess with your cable.
Exactly, and you can wrap it around and make sure that's out of the way for your customer.
Well, so I see there's not much missing and you're shipping.
Yes.
So congratulations to this very nice and very perfect product.
Thank you very much. Thanks for your support.
And thank you for your time.